Hey everyone, welcome to Let's Play Dungeon Hack Redux. This LP has been brought to you by longtime viewer Kostya, who requested this game during the Great Donation Drive of 2013. I've done one of the requested games so far, and that was Pawful Mail, and it's been about a year. So I'd like to be a little bit more expedient in fulfilling the rest of these requests. Not that I'm going to rush through this or anything, but I'm going to try to finish this in a more timely manner than Pawful Mail. It took me, what, like 8 months or something? Pathetic like that. I feel horrible. Anyway, I did LP this game before. That one is incomplete, but you can go back and watch that if you want. If you want to watch the intro, I have a video that's just the intro to this game. So click Show Intro in the video, and through the magic of the internet, it should take you right there. I think I'm allowed to do that. If not, then there will be a link in the description, so click that instead. Actually, there will probably be both. Anyway, enough jibber-jabber, let's get the show on the road. Now, rather than sit here rerolling stats all day, I'm going to use one of the pre-generated characters, but instead of picking the character, since I'm an egomaniac and I want to name the character after myself, I want to go in and do it like this. This character will be a male human cleric of the chaotic good persuasion. If you're familiar with this game, then you probably saw that coming, me choosing a cleric. It's pretty much the only class to play in this game. This character, okay, brief rundown of the stats for non-D&D nerds. The stats are a score from 3 to 18, 18 being the best, basically superhuman, 3 being pathetically weak. This character has a 15 strength, so I'll leave that the way it is. He has a 13 intelligence, which is still good, that's above average. He has an 18 wisdom, which is the important thing if you are a cleric. He has a 14 dexterity. 16 constitution, which is nice, and a 13 charisma, which is still good, although I don't think we'll be doing much talking in this game, so the charisma probably won't be that important. Although there are cleric abilities that use charisma, I'm not up enough on my second edition D&D to know which ones. So yeah, this all looks, oh wait, hit points, of course. I have 29 hit points, which I could have gone with 33 and just left it like that, but I'm going to try to do this as honestly as possible. And for my character portrait, my favorite one, and the one I always chose when I played this game as a kid, is this one. Just kind of a little bit more badass looking than the rest of these. I mean, most of the faces are kind of goofy, to be perfectly honest. Yeah. Badass looking knight, and this character's name will be, drumroll please, since it's a fantasy setting, you can pretend that he's from, you know, some area called the Bump. So I played a little bit of practice on easy, and this is what I was going to do an LP of, the easy difficulty, but I actually think I'll be able to handle moderate. Easy, I would be too worried that it would get boring. I mean, I'm already a little bit worried that this LP is going to be boring. Full disclosure, I've had like 3 false starts trying to record this video. I've gotten like 10 minutes into playing and I just ran out of stuff to talk about and I just kind of froze up. So I'm going to try to prevent that from happening this time. I think I was just in a bad mood that day and I just couldn't finish it. But before I pick moderate, let's go into the custom settings and see what the differences between the difficulties are. If you're playing along at home, you can use this dungeon seed to, you can plug this into the customizer, I probably shouldn't have clicked that. Alright, you can plug this into the customizer to play the exact same dungeon I am, which should be fun to play along at home. Alright, so on easy settings, let's see what these settings are like. Yeah, a lot of the hazards are turned off or turned down. There were just billions of keys. It was weird. Just keys everywhere. It got a little annoying, to be honest. Food consumption is monster difficulty low, magic power. Wait. Oh, I guess this is... Oh, okay. That's set to high. Never mind. Yeah, let's see what moderate looks like. Is there anything here that I would object to? Monster difficulty. Okay, multi-level puzzles off. That's good, because multi-level puzzles, that's like where you have to carry a key from level 1 to level 5 to unlock a door on level 5. And if you don't pick up the key, you have to go all the way back to level 1 and get it and come back. Yeah, probably nothing that harsh, but but it could get annoying. I think I'm going to turn water level off. I always turn that off when I played as a kid. I never actually encountered a water level, but everyone said that it was just a pain in the ass to deal with, so I turned it off. Alright, other than that, everything looks pretty good. This is the thing I'm probably the most concerned about. On moderate, the dungeon is 18 levels long. On easy, it's only 10. And I've never finished the game on moderate, I don't think. I finished on easy, I'm pretty sure. So I don't know how tough this game gets in the later levels. But, you know, I want to make this... I want to make this fun to watch, so I'm going to go with moderate. I could go with hard. Nah, let's not. Alright. Water level off. Here's the dungeon seed I'm playing. Pause it and write it down if you want to. I guess there's no reason to save these settings if I'm not going to do more than one game of this. I think I'm ready. For tonight's musical selection, I have the soundtrack... Oh my god, speaking of keys. Good gravy. I have the soundtrack to the game Sword and Sorcery playing. This game doesn't have any in-game music. There's just music that plays in a few cutscenes. So I will be filling this LP with appropriate fantasy music from other games. Alright. Boy, maybe it was moderate that had all the keys. So, brief overview for people who didn't watch the first LP or are just unfamiliar with this game in general. This is a randomly generated dungeon. There are monsters running around. There are traps. The reason I chose to play a cleric is because there are many situations where this game's nearly impossible if you aren't a cleric, to be perfectly honest. You have a health meter, which is just standard, and you have a food meter, which slowly runs down through the course of the game. I didn't pick hard, did I? No, I guess not. Okay. It just seems weird that... Seems like there's a lot more keys right off the bat than there were in any of my practice runs. But yeah, your food meter slowly drains down, and in my experience, the thing that's most likely to kill you is running out of food. Because once you run out of food, your health drains. It drains pretty slowly. It drains like one hit point every 24 hours or something. But if you're starving, you're not able to heal, which is a problem. So... the cleric eventually gets a spell called Generate Food and Water. Actually, speaking of spells, I need to go in and reconfigure some of my spells. These enemies that I'm fighting have been orcs, which are just very standard humanoid enemies. There's not much to them. It's almost impossible to actually get hit by them if you're playing the game properly. Just kind of first level cannon fodder. So, for a cleric, you go to the Pray for Spells menu to choose what spells you want. I want to keep Cure Light Wounds, because that's, like, the standard spell for a cleric. That's like, your number one jam. I'm also going to take Bless, which I believe in 2nd edition D&D, it increases your chance to hit and your damage by 1. I'm not sure if that's the exact effect in this game, but it makes you better at fighting overall. The rest of these could be useful in some situations, but not at the moment. So I might come back to re-choose some of these later. I have level 2 spells. I'm probably not going to use Whole Person. It's a good spell, but it doesn't really suit the way I typically play this game. To start out, I'm going to take 2 Aid and 2 Flame Blade. Aid is just temporary hit points, basically. It gives you anywhere from 1 to 8. Flame Blade is a magical weapon, which it appears in your hand. And well, here, I'll just show you how it works. Once you choose your spells, you just hit rest. And whatever spells you chose, you now have access to. To open your spell menu, you click on your holy symbol as a cleric. So I'm going to go ahead and bless myself. Keep that buff on as much as possible. And I also have Turn Undead, which if I run into an undead enemy, it basically just makes them run away. Aid, my HP bar turned blue, so that's how you know that one's in effect. And then for Flame Blade, I have to have an empty hand and click it. Now the downside to using Flame Blade is that you can no longer use this hand for anything else until the spell expires, but I shouldn't need to anytime soon. The Flame Blade is better than the standard mace, but if I find a magic weapon, I might start using that instead. So I'm playing with the number pad to move around. I mentioned in one of my Mario videos that I was using auto hotkey to remap the keyboard so I could use... Wow, I actually got hit because I clicked that by mistake. I mentioned that I was using auto hotkey to remap the controls so I could use WASD, W-A-S-D. But for some reason, that's no longer working, and I can't figure out why. Like, it was working fine during my my practice runs, but now I don't know what changed. I can't get it to work. So my recording setup is kind of awkward. I have my keyboard shoved all the way over to the left, with half of the keyboard hanging off the left side of my desk. And then my left hand is on the number pad, and then my right hand is on the mouse. But I mean, it works. It's just a little uncomfortable. I'm emulating this in DOSBox, which has the CPU speed turned all the way up. So this is much faster and much smoother than the game was when I played it as a kid. It's actually quite nice. I mean, basically, the settings I'm playing on are as if my computer was the fastest computer in the world in 1993. So yeah, I click the map and it just immediately comes up. There's not like the few second pause that you would normally have. Which this is really the way to play this game, in my opinion. There's the auto map, of course, which follows me around wherever I go. Yeah, if you're for those of you watching at home, you'll probably be able to follow where I'm going more easily by looking at down here rather than up here, since I do tend to move pretty quickly. I have a bad habit of looking at this instead of looking up here, which normally it's not a big deal since most of the information you need appears on the minimap, but occasionally you'll have little alcoves in the walls that contain items, and sometimes I'll miss those because I'm looking down here instead of up here. So I need to train myself not to do that. Right, let's take care of these orcs, and then I will show off some of these items, explain what some of these do. I'm using a strategy that I didn't really use that much when I played as a kid, which is to stick and move. Basically, you take a hit and then you run away, or you take a swipe, you attack, and then you run away. So it's pretty hard to get hit by these low-level enemies if you stick to those tactics. Okay, so these are all keys, obviously. This is a rock. Rocks have a few uses. You can throw them at enemies. I actually killed them with that. They don't do a ton of damage. You can use them to hold down pressure plates, which is important for solving puzzles later on. This is a moonstone, which is actually just a key in a different form. There's going to be, like, a slot on a wall to place a moonstone and it'll open a door. I found a tan potion, and I'm not going to use that right off the bat. The best thing to do with potions is to wait until you have some way of nullifying poison, because the potions aren't going to kill you right away. There's no like instant death potion or anything, but you still want to be, a little bit careful with them. I think poison is the worst thing that can happen to you. You can be paralyzed by a potion, which kind of sucks, but really all that does is make it so you can't attack. You can still run away. Paralysis doesn't really have any teeth in this game. I found an amulet, so I'm going to go ahead and test that. Well, I should wait until I find an enemy. Contrary to what you might think, you don't necessarily want to put an amulet around your neck. Ooh. Man, he hit me right before I teleported away. Okay, so this is an amulet of imminent return, which is... it's situationally useful. At the moment, that just... That set me back a little bit, but if I'm ever in a situation where I'm cornered by an enemy and I need to escape quickly, then that's going to be pretty invaluable. I'll place it around my neck for now, even though it doesn't do anything there. Actually, I'll place it in one of my quick item slots, which doesn't really. There's no reason to put it there, but it just I have easier access to it there. So I've also killed three goblins, which are basically the same thing as orcs. Not to be racist or anything, but they pretty much behave exactly the same. They don't have any special attacks or anything. They just kind of stumble around stupidly, which is a pretty good description of what I was doing just now. There are decorations on the walls. For the most part, none of them actually do anything. It's just flavor text, and it's not very interesting flavor text. This tapestry appears to be dedicated to the element of water. I wonder how I came to that conclusion. So, those are the basics of the game. Obviously, it gets a lot more complicated later on. Your goal in each level is to find the exit to the next level, and there are 18 of them. If you watch the intro, it mentions something about finding an orb for a sorceress. I'm not really that worried about the orb, to be perfectly honest. I'm mostly worried about getting as much treasure as possible and getting out of here. There are secret passages scattered throughout the dungeon. If you want to be super anal when you play this game, then you walk into every wall as you maneuver throughout the dungeon. But I don't usually play like that. I usually only look for secret passages if it looks like an obvious place where they would put one, or if I don't know where else to go. If there are no obvious exits, then I'll start moving around and bumping into walls. I don't like doing that too much though, because the sound effect it makes when you bump into a wall is just really kind of obnoxious. And if I do miss an alcove on a wall because I'm not paying attention, feel free to yell at me and call me an idiot, because I probably deserve it. Okay, it looks like this corner is where I need to head, although, well, I guess this corridor could make a turn here and branch off up here. Unfortunately, I don't have access to this hallway or this door or this room. This symbol is, it's basically a wall. You can't move through it. It's a window, so you can see part of the dungeon, but you can't, like, there's no trick to getting through there. It's just a barrier. So, my aid spell expired, so I should go ahead and re-up that one. To get your spells back, all you have to do is rest. And to rest, all you have to do is not have an enemy nearby. There's no penalty for resting. You can do it as much as you want. However, it does take food the more time you spend resting. And if you're not a cleric, it can take a ridiculous amount of time to get back up to full health, especially if you are very hurt. There's just a multitude of reasons you want to play a cleric in this game. Not only can you generate food and water, basically once you hit level... let's see, you start out at level 4, I think it's level 6 that you first get the generate food and water spell. Let me double check. Oh, it doesn't show you what the higher level spells are. Pretty sure it's a level 3 spell, and you get access to those at level 6. So, once you're at level 6, you don't have to worry about food at all. One of the facts I was looking at recommends playing a multi-class character, playing like a fighter cleric or a cleric mage. The fact agrees that being a cleric is the only way to go, but where we differ in opinion... Ooh, that's a lot of stuff. Wow. Where we differ in our opinions is the fact says it's good to multi-class, but I disagree. Let's see what this parchment says. Oh, that looks like a hint. Use fire against mummies. When you play a multi-class character, they don't share experience. Or rather, they do share experience. So if you're a fighter mage and you kill something that gives you 100 experience, that's 50 experience to the fighter side, 50 experience to the mage side. So it takes you twice as long to level up either of those classes. And God help you if you're one of the triple class characters. I mean, it's possible to be like a fighter, mage, cleric in this game, but I do not recommend it. Alright, so I picked up a bunch of items. I picked up a ring, which I don't want to wear just yet in case it's cursed. However, what I will do is I'm going to get a Detect Magic. I'll swap out Accumulate Wounds for Detect Magic, and I'll see if this mace is magical. Because if it is, then it can take the place of my Flame Blade. I think weapons can be cursed, but I don't know if it's ever happened to me. So, I'll have fun finding that out. Alright. By the way, when you're in the camp menu, you can manipulate your inventory all you want. You can open up your... Oh, I thought you could open up your spell menu. I guess not. But, like, say I'm in a sticky situation where it looks like I'm going to die. I'm cornered. I have an enemy, you know, breathing down my neck. You can hit the camp button, and I can swap my holy symbol out for that, and then I can break camp and then immediately click that once I leave, transporting me to the exit. I mean, you still have to be kind of quick, because as you saw earlier, the enemy hit me while I was still kind of in the process of teleporting, so that can still happen. But you can go to the camp menu anytime, you just can't rest unless there are no monsters around. Alright, so let's cast Detect Magic and see about that mace. Okay, awesome. It is indeed a magical mace. I'm going to go ahead and use it. Hopefully it's not cursed. Alright, if it's cursed, I wouldn't be able to take it out of that item slot. So, good. That'll take the place of my Flame Blade. So I picked up some more rations, which is nice. We're doing okay on food for now, but I'll have to eat here pretty soon. This coin, there are, I don't know what they're called, shrines, I guess, scattered throughout the dungeon, and they have a slot where you can place a coin, and if you put a silver coin in the slot, it heals you all the way, and if you put a gold coin in the slot, it heals you all the way and cures you of any ailments. So if you're poisoned, it'll cure you. If you're held or paralyzed, it'll cure you of that. Ooh, very nice. This grappling hook will be essential later in the dungeon when we start finding pits. So the best time to test a potion is when you're near one of those shrines and you have a gold coin. Because if you get poisoned or paralyzed or whatever, you can immediately use a shrine and cure your ailment. I have to say, I'm really liking the soundtrack so far. I didn't play a ton of Sword and Sorcery, but I need to go back to it sometime. Music is kind of perfect for this game, actually. It reminds me a little bit of the music to Eye of the Beholder on Sega CD, which is a game very similar to this one. Alright, why can I not open this door? Is there a hidden button around somewhere? Doesn't look like it, which means this door probably only opens from the other side. It's probably locked from that side. So, let's see. If I can't go through there, okay, there's a path over here that I didn't take. This is one of those slot machines. I have no reason to use it right now, but if I get hurt, then I should remember this is here. Now, obviously, these are way more helpful if you're not playing a cleric, because they allow you to heal without, you know, resting and using a ton of food. But as a cleric, they're not as useful to me. Well, that's weird. I was kind of hoping there would be something over here. Alright, well, where should I go now? Can't go through that door. Oh, there's a little tiny bit down here that I didn't explore. If this isn't the exit, I'm going to have to start bumping into walls. That kind of sucks. Oh well, let's head down there. But yeah, Eye of the Beholder... Oh wait, I didn't see this before. Eye of the Beholder is a great game. It was one of my favorite games for a long time when I was a kid. Oh crap. It's, you have a party instead of just one dude, so you can... You have a lot more options available to you in terms of what your characters can do. You can have, like, a thief and a mage and a fighter and all that. The levels aren't randomly generated. They're, you know, someone designed them. But there's actually a story in the game, and there are, like, NPCs you can run into and all kinds of cool stuff. I should probably... If this goes well, if this Dungeon Hack LP goes well, I should probably either... try doing one on hard or do Eye of the Beholder. I think that would be a lot of fun. It would have to be the Sega CD version though, because that version had really good music. Well, let's see. The most obvious place for there to be a secret door would be either in this room or in this room, it looks like, because there's a big empty space here. Well, there's a big empty space here too. So let's try this room. Another one of my bad habits is not using the strafe keys enough. I'm more apt to turn and take a step to the left or right instead of use the strafe keys. If you use the strafe keys advantageously, then or if you use them intelligently, it can be very advantageous to you. So yeah, when I was a kid, I basically just stood toe to toe with them and just traded blows, which I don't think is they intended the game to be played that way, because I actually read the manual before I started this, and it mentions the tip you can attack while moving a couple times. So I think they intended for you to kind of move around all over the place while you were fighting, like a boxer. Stick and move. Float like a butterfly. Sting like a bee. Man, I'm going to feel really dumb if there's like a way to go that I was just missing. Oh wait. I feel really dumb. Oh, see, I thought I couldn't go this way because I saw this, and I thought, well, I'm blocked from going that way, but I didn't realize there was a door there. Okay. See, I could have dodged a little bit more deftly if I strafed instead of dancing around like that. Alright, my detect magic potion is still in effect, or my detect magic spell is in effect, so I can see that the silver potion is magical. I don't know if there are non-magical potions in this game. There might just be, like, a vial of water or something. A lot of roguelike type games have, like, a fool's gold potion that doesn't do anything. I hear a scarier monster than orcs and goblins. Or maybe that's the music. I don't know. I can't tell. So as with most games of this type, it is a good idea to explore as much of the levels as possible. Because, I mean, you never know what you might find. Oh, okay. This is where I use this moonstone. Interesting. On a literal picture of the moon. Since there are no multi-level puzzles, then I know that there is a door for each one of these keys on this level somewhere. It's just a matter of finding them. Actually, that might not be true. I'm not sure. I should probably not let myself get trapped in that corner. Ooh, bracers. I will save those for when I have some way of disposing of curses. There are a few ways to do that in this game. Wow, I'm getting hit more than I should be here. Let's go ahead and cure myself a little bit. So this game is basically a cover-based shooter, except that you're not shooting. It's a cover-based slasher. Stop and pop, baby. Stop and pop. So I had a hard time deciding what music I should play during these, or if I should play music at all. I mean, it feels really weird to play a game like this with no music. It feels kind of depressing, to be honest. Like, you're all alone in this dungeon. You're the only friendly character in the whole place. It's kind of like Metroid that way. There are no friendly faces in this game. It is all monsters and traps all the way down. And when there's no music playing, it's all the more lonely and isolating and kind of gloomy. So I'm glad I picked something nice to play. Something nice to listen to. Cheer me up a little bit. And I have a few other game soundtracks I will break out as well. I don't know how long this is going to be. I'm anticipating each of these levels being at least... I mean, I'm already at 32 minutes for this one. Now, granted, that is a lot of me stopping and explaining things. Oops. I threw the key instead of using it. It's not a good idea to use keys that way. Okay, my detect magic spell expired. That's all that was. I need to redo... I'll tell you what I need to do. I need to redo my bless and redo my aid. I was walking around unbuffed. No wonder I was sucking. Oh, wow. I still missed even with the... Wow. You know, clerics aren't the best character in the world for hitting things. But you know, that's okay. Because you can make up for a lack of ability to hit things with... playing the game dexterously. So yeah, I mean, definitely later in the game, I'm anticipating these videos getting up into, like, you know, around an hour apiece. And they're 18 levels, so this is probably, I'm going to say, once I finish this, which I will, this will be the longest LP I've ever done. And you know, I'm looking forward to it. I always wanted to dive into, like, a big, meaty kind of game with a lot of exploration and, you know, strategy and statistics and numbers. See, I'm a big numbers nerd. I like RPGs a lot. I like strategy games a lot. I never LP or stream those kinds of games because... I don't know. I mean, I guess a part of me is worried that I'm not going to be able to make it entertaining. And part of me is worried that that I'm just going to suck at it. Because, I mean, I'm good at Mario. I know how to jump on platforms and stomp on Goombas. I mean, I know how to play this game too, but I'm not nearly as good at these types of games as I am 2D platformers. So I guess we'll see how it goes. Like I said, I did have a few false starts when I started recording this, and I had to stop and restart a few times. But like I said, I think I was just having a bad day, because I seem to be doing okay now. Maybe I was just playing the wrong music. I started out playing the Dragon Age soundtrack. Because, I mean, Dragon Age is basically a D&D game, just without the license, you know? And, I mean, it was good, but it wasn't, I don't know, it wasn't as cheery as this. I mean, not that, you know, this game has to be cheery, because, like I said, this is a pretty, this is a pretty, dreary game. Oh my god, there's a lot of enemies in there. I saw something moving around. Okay. I believe that's a bugbear. And not like the colloquialism, like an actual bugbear. I don't know what the colloquialism bugbear means. I've heard it a few times. I think it means like a pet peeve or something. Like, oh yeah, that's a real bugbear for me. I don't know. Well, I'm kind of cornered here. I mean, I have the exit right here. I could just go down. But I want to explore this big room a little bit first. Maybe I should still be using Flame Blade. I don't know. This mace doesn't seem to be cutting it. Get it? Because it's a bashing weapon, not a cutting weapon? Oh my god, I'm so clever. So I was playing a game on moderate for one of my my practice sessions, and I was doing pretty well, but this time, I don't know, wow, this guy is taking a lot more hits than he was the last time I played. Maybe this mace isn't all it's cut out to be. Get it? Because it's a mace and it can't cut anything? Okay, whew, thank god. Was that a bugbear? Yes, it was. 26 goblins, 35 orcs, and a bugbear. That guy's a lot tougher than I gave him credit for. Alright, he had a scroll of detect magic, which is nice. He had some bracers, which might be nice. And he had a periwinkle potion, which is a very lovely color. Alright, I forget if shields can be cursed or not. I kind of don't want to try it. Oh, I forgot to mention, I'm only going to do one save per level. Because I don't want to save scum. I mean, I could save my game, try all these items to see if they're cursed, and then load my game if I get a cursed item, but I don't want to do that. This game is kind of inspired by roguelikes, and I feel like that would be against the spirit of playing a roguelike. Like, if this was Rogue or NetHack or something, I would never be able to do that. I'll tell you what, though, I should rest, because I have, well, actually, first, I should eat. Oops. Oh, I see. I started resting and then I stopped. Okay, I should eat some food first, just to make sure. Okay, now I'll rest. See, it only took me 9 hours, whereas if I wasn't a cleric, it probably would have taken somewhere in the 20 to 40 hour range to heal all the way with the amount of health I had. So yeah, clerics are the way to go in this game. Maybe I should go back to using Flame Blade. I don't know. I seemed to be doing better with it than I was with my magical mace. Or I don't know, maybe it was a cursed mace and weapons don't stick to your hand like I thought they did. Maybe that's only armor that sticks. See, I just did 10 points of damage with that, and the most I was doing with a mace was like 8, I think. So yeah, I'll stick with the Flame Blade for a little while longer. Unfortunately, there's no, like, it doesn't show you your attack stat or your Thaco or anything, so you can't really tell which weapon is better except by trial and error, which is kind of a bummer. Alright, is there anywhere else I need to go before I head down the steps? Yeah, let's check out this last door real quick. Just to fully flesh out my map. Leave no stone unturned and all that. I also haven't been playing as smartly as I could be because, you know, I'm talking and explaining stuff while I play. But don't worry, I won't do that once this game actually starts getting hard. I mean, I will, but hopefully I won't do it quite as incompetently. Jesus, look at all these enemies. It almost feels like I'm playing on hard. I don't know. This seems like a lot more stuff than when I played on moderate before. I need to rewatch my video and make sure I didn't choose hard by mistake. But if I did, I'm pretty sure it would be 25 levels instead of 18. Well, I said this would be real quick, but I didn't anticipate there being a horde of orcs. Protection from poison, nice. I could drink that and then test all my potions. In fact, let's do that before I head down the stairs. I'm done. I went to every single possible location in this level of the dungeon. Actually, I guess I should save my potions until I have duplicates of them, just in case. Do I have a duplicate of anything? No, I don't think. What the? Ekru? Is that a color? Kinda wish I had a scroll of identify. Or a magic mirror, that would be nice as well. Alright, well, I'm gonna play safe and hang on to what I have for now. And, that'll do it for level 1. Let me consult my manual here. Let's see, page 19. The fifth word on page 19, or the fifth word under the heading, is move. That's what they did back in the old days to make sure you don't copy games and give your friends the copies. They make you look something up in the manual to continue. Alright, so this is level 2, and we're doing pretty well so far. We have a nice little complement of items here. I'm too afraid to use any of them, but hopefully some of them will be useful someday. So tune in tomorrow to see what level 2 of Dungeon Hack holds for us. Level 2. I guess I should have made a save at the beginning of level 1, but I guess it doesn't really matter. Those were all my practice saves. So yeah, I'm Duke the Bump, and I will see you tomorrow.